Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. How are you doing this morning? Are we nice and warm? Are you finally warm? Yes? Won't you stand with us? We're going to do something we hadn't done in a long time in this church. If you notice, there's this old dusty red book in front of you. Won't you take that book out, crack the spine, don't blow the dust off of it. And we're not even going to put the lyrics up on the screen this morning. You're going to have to do something that you haven't done in a long, long time, and that's read. Okay? So we're going to start on number 624, the doxology. That's how they used to start church long, long time ago. You couldn't have church without the doxology a long time ago. So we'll start with the doxology. Page 624. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, O creatures here below. Praise Him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Y'all better bring your glasses out. We're going to page 195. Page 195, we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. What can wash?
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What a verse two.
For my pardon this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing, this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
One of verse four.
This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Nothing but us.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
One more time.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
All right, y'all can be seated, but keep those books handy. Well, good morning. Can you take this wire? I got about 40 wires I got to take off. That's okay. Good morning. My name is John. If you don't know me, I'm the youth minister, worship minister here at Community Baptist, and we're glad that you joined us in person, glad that you joined us online. And just so glad to see you. We are doing a hymn book worship this morning. Oh, yeah? Okay, just me. Just me and Jeff. Jeff Clark actually requested this, and he's not in. And I'm glad to do it, because there's so much rich theology and beautiful words in the hymns. So we're going to pay homage to that this morning. Now, as for announcements, a couple of things coming up. The Women's Spring Retreat is on April 29th to May 1st. That is at the end of next month, so they need y'all signed up. Ladies, you got to get signed up. Price is $185. That's what I said, $185. And it's going to be in Lake Conroe, so it's going to be a good time. Disciple Now is in 2 weeks. I got to get kids signed up. Get your kids signed up. It's $50, okay? $50 is going to be here, and then we're going to join with Journey Dayton on Saturday night and come back here on Sunday morning. Have a great guest speaker, a guy that I've been itching to have here for a long, long time. Harry O. Brown's a friend of mine. And the topic is identity out of 1 John, since we struggle with what is identity anymore in our society. Speaking of youth, we have the Impact Youth Camp coming up in June. We also need to start signing up for that. Go ahead and just start getting your name on the list, because that list fills up. And the more kids we have, the more adults we have to take. So just remember that we got to have kids going in. As for mission trips, the kids have their mission trip on July 24th. The price is $280. You want to talk to Christy about that? She already has the kids that are pretty much going, which ones that are not. But if you want your kid to go to that, they got to start in it's in March. They'll start training for that, right? Or is it in May? In May, y'all start training for that. So it's actually, if y'all don't know about this, the L.I.T. program, when they do a mission trip, they take the kids up there, they train them for months before they go on the mission trip, and then when they take the kids out to do a VBS or an evangelical mission, and the kids run it. The kids are witnessing. The kids are bringing the gospel. The kids are telling other kids about the Lord, and it's a beautiful, beautiful thing. So again, make sure that you're involved in that. Now, April 2nd, we're going to have a cleanup work day. That's not on your bulletin, but on the April 2nd, we're going to have an all hands on deck cleanup work day in the church. We need everybody here for a few hours to just kind of deep clean and find some things. And Van's going to put a list together of the things, some things that we need to do, and we're going to find some stuff as a staff, some things that we as a church need to do, because April the 9th, the next Saturday, we're having our Easter blowout. Okay, our Easter blowout. That's the Saturday before Palm Sunday. It's going to be 11 to 2. And y'all are donating candy. Continue to donate candy. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Donate the candy, put them in the eggs, tape them up, no chocolate. Easy, right? The other thing we need right now is we need people to volunteer for games, for activities. We need people to volunteer for floaters. We need y'all to volunteer for this. And this is going to be, we don't get to do the drive-in right now because of all the construction. This is going to take the place of that this year. And we want this to be massive. We're going to start a radio campaign. We're going to start putting this on Facebook. We want to start walking through the back here into Heathergate and into Indian Shores and inviting people to come, because there are so many people that are new in this area. They have no idea where to go to church, and we can be a true community church. Excuse me. Now, spring break is next week, March the 14th to the 18th. There'll be no Wednesday service over spring break. We have the 55-plus trip to Newman's Castle in Beeville. It's spelled, ma'am? May 14. May 14. Thank you. And last but not least, we have the men's fishing trip. Yeah. We have the men's fishing trip. Men's fishing trip is $155. It's September 30th to October 2nd. It's Friday through Sunday morning. Is your hand up? Do what? I'm going to get there. Zeke has his hand up like he's asking a question in class. Thank you for stopping me. Yes, the men's fishing trip, it's a great time that we get together, men, and it's, like I said, it's a great, great time. Now, this is for the men, not their sons yet. We've talked about that before. There's some liability things of being around the water, having kids around. It's tough to do. So this is for adults 18 and up. Yes, Michael? 18 and up? 18 and up. $155 a person, and it's $55 deposit. Now, the $55 deposit must be paid by April the 15th, or your name will be struck from the list and you'll go on the waiting list. And somebody who has paid their deposit will go on to the list, because this does fill up. It does fill up. So make sure that you get that deposit in by April 15th. And then finally, Paul said finally 3 times in Ephesians and 2 times in, Paul said finally is one of his favorite words. But we have a business meeting today after church, a regular business meeting. come and discuss, and we give updates. We'll do just a normal business meeting, so you're welcome to come in and sit in on that. We have about 10 minutes after church to let you fellowship and mingle for a minute. We'll come back in and have our regular scheduled business meeting. Is there anything else that I'm forgetting? Nothing? All right, if we could have our men and the sons and grandsons down for a time of men's prayer. This is the time when we bow our knees and symbolically bow our hearts to the Father this morning. So y'all bow as we pray. Father, we thank you for the morning you've given us. We thank you for the chance to be here in a place and a time where we're not worried about somebody coming in the back door and telling us we can't do that. We thank you for putting us here. It is a privilege, Father. It is more than a privilege, Lord, that you've given, much, much more than we deserve. So we thank you for just the ability to be here. We pray, Father, just let us last. Let us persist. Let us give us the strength to go to tomorrow, Father. And let us be fired this morning. Let us be forged this morning in your spirit and in the hot fire of your word this morning, Lord. So that we can go out as a sharpened sword into the world. We pray for healing across this church, Father, whether it be physical or spiritual or congregational, Father. We pray for healing such that only you can take credit for it. And then, Lord, we dedicate this service to you this morning as a sacrifice of praise, a sacrifice of worship, a wave offering, if it will, Father, to your ears and to your nostrils, where it's a sweet sound or a sweet smell to your ears. And we give you all glory and praise and deserve none of it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Y'all shake somebody's hand. You go back to your seat. And then turn in your hymnals to page 493. Page 493, we're going to do verses 1, 3, and 4. Like a with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. Turn to page number 43. Great is thy faithfulness. Come thou long expected Jesus.
release us, let us find our rest in thee. May Israel strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, the dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart.
Verse 2.
Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom bring. By thine own eternal spirit, rule in all our hearts alone, by thine all sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne.
Sing, by thine own eternal spirit.
By thine own eternal spirit, rule in all our hearts alone. By thine all sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne.
Y'all pray with me as Michael comes up to preach. Father, we thank you again for the chance to worship you this morning. We thank you for the chance to give sacrifice of praise to you. We ask that you speak through Michael this morning. Make the message your message. Let your words come out of his mouth. Let your voice come out of his mouth. Where we hear you and we hear what you want to say this morning. Take over this service. Take over all of it. And we'll give it to you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hey, watch it. No, it's good to be in God's house. It's good to see you here this morning. And I feel comfortable with this mic in my hand, so that's a good thing. We're going to be in John chapter 8, and we're going to go through verses 1 through 12. If you go ahead and stand, and we'll read God's word. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Now early in the morning he came again to the temple, and all the people came to him, and he sat down and taught them. Then the scribes and the Pharisees brought to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery, and in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what do you say?" This they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground with his finger, as though he had not heard or did not hear. So when they continued asking him, he raised himself and said to them, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." Again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And then those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the oldest even to the last. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had raised himself up, he saw no one but the woman. He said to her, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No, no one, Lord." Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have light of life." Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your word. Father, we thank you for teaching us and showing us your scriptures. Father, we pray that you would show us what you want us to see in this lesson this morning. We love you, and we honor you. And to you all the glory, Father, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. All right. The title of this lesson is, What's Their Motive? And we know the stories about Jesus, he was teaching in the temple, teaching. And can you imagine him teaching? And all, you know, it's just like this morning, we're here in church and we're all sitting down and we're comfortable, we're listening to God's word. And all of a sudden, you know, there's this disruption comes in. And this is what happened to Jesus. He was teaching about what he had come to do, being an example and teaching about his word. And all of a sudden, the Pharisees show up. They brought this woman in. They caught her in adultery, caught her in the very act. But they were hoping to say that they'd caught Jesus. They'd brought her in right in the middle and interrupted everything, which they were pretty good at doing. But I want to point out three things in this scripture just about the Pharisees and the way they acted and what they did. And they tried to entangle and accuse and test him in different areas. And I'm going to share with you some scriptures that show that what they did over and over. Now, the more you try to share the gospel, the more opposition you're going to get. Just the way it goes. And the devil wants us not to succeed. But Jesus, if you'll notice in the scripture how Jesus always turns it around. He always puts the ball back in their court. So let's look at another example of that. Mark chapter 12, 12 through 17. Let's go there. Mark chapter 12. Let's see what it says. And they sought, in verse 12, and they sought to lay hands on him, but feared the multitude, for they knew he had spoken the parable against them. So they left him and went away. The Pharisees had came, see, in verse 13, they'd come to talk about paying taxes. That was their question. But in verse 13, it says, then they sent to him some of the Pharisees and the Herodians to catch him in his words. When they had come, they said to him, Teacher, we know that you are true and care about no one, for you do not regard the person of men, but teach the way of God in truth. Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? And this was their question to him. So they're always trying to trip him up in the law, trying to get him to do something wrong. And we see that example here. They were trying to catch him. They were trying to entangle him. This example is given several times in the Bible. Also, in Luke chapter 20, verse 20, the same thing. It says, So they watched him as they sent spies who pretended to be righteous that they might seize on his words. Okay? They're watching him in every move. And this is the same example in Luke that was in Mark. But it's worded a little bit different. It's recorded a little bit different, but it's the same thing. Their motive was the same. So we look at motives and what they were doing. They were trying to stop Jesus doing good works, okay? And this is what we see in the scripture. And they also, in Mark chapter 3, verses 1 through 6, Jesus was trying to heal on the Sabbath day. And they always showed up on the scene. And you see, Sadducees and Pharisees were responsible for just watching people to make sure they didn't break the laws or kept up with the things correctly. But the Pharisees were looking at laws of their father more than the laws of Jesus. And so we see the example of the crippled man and how Jesus healed his hand on the Sabbath in Mark chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Let's go there real quick. Mark chapter 3. It says, he entered the synagogue again, and a man was there who had a withered hand. So they watched him closely. They're looking at Jesus, watching him closely, whether he would heal on the Sabbath, so that they might accuse him. And he said to the man who had the withered hand, step forward. And then he said to them, is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or kill? And that was Jesus talking there. And we see in the original text how Jesus was confronted by the Pharisees about this question. You know, we've caught this woman in adultery, and Moses' law, Moses says, he had written down in the commands and God's law, and Moses in the law said that she should be stoned. That was the question he had been faced with. But Jesus, every time he was faced with something like that, he always put the ball in their court. He turned it around to where he was going to continue to accomplish what he set out to do. And that was to teach people lessons about the true love of God, the Father that sent him. The Pharisees were looking to accuse, and that's what they were doing in this situation, the key scriptures. They were looking to accuse him. In Luke chapter 6, verse 7, they were trying to find an accusation against him. Okay? And this was the same scripture as far as the same story in Mark as in Luke. The same man had came, and it was just recorded in Luke. It says the same man that had the withered hand. They were trying to find Jesus to accusations against Jesus. Okay? And then the Pharisees accused her, but they also accused Jesus. Something to accuse him of also was in John chapter 8, verse 6. They said they were going to accuse him, or they were wanting to. And no matter what happens, no one was going to touch Jesus until it was time. God's scripture was going to be fulfilled, and no one was going to be able to get to Jesus until it was time. So he continued to teach regardless. So he's in the middle of teaching something. They bring her in, and then he is able to actually turn it around and teach them something besides what he was trying to teach. So they show up and interrupt everything and bring her in. Matthew chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, says that at that time Jesus went through the grain fields. Another time they tried to accuse him. Went through the grain fields on the Sabbath, and his disciples were hungry and began to pluck heads of grain to eat. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said, isn't it unlawful to do on the Sabbath? Isn't it unlawful to work on the Sabbath? So they were more concerned about the law than they were about taking care of people. And this is Jesus' point that, you know, the thing we have to remember that Jesus he wrote the law. He knows the law better than they do. And he came not to destroy it, not to take it away, but to fulfill it, to fulfill the law. And this is what he was trying to do. But at each corner, each time he turned around the corner, they tried to stop him. So they continued to test him, try to test him. And back in John, original key text, John chapter 8, verse 6, they were testing him. In the same sentence that they were trying to accuse him, they were testing him. So then in the story in Matthew chapter 22, verse 18, Jesus asked this question. It was when they were asking about the taxes. Who do you pay taxes to? Do we pay them to Caesar? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar? And Jesus asked them, this is his words, why do you test me, you hypocrites? Why do you test me? So Jesus was God in the flesh, but he got upset when they tried to do this. He was man enough to get upset, and when they tried to stop him doing the work of his Father, he said, "Why do you test me? Why do you do this?" But Jesus knows, and the thing about it is, in the story that we're reading here, in our key text about this, when he was teaching in the temple, he was. He knew their thoughts. He knew why they brought her in. He knew exactly why that she was brought in. He knew their motives. He knew their motives. The title is, What's Their Motive? He knew their motives. Was it truly to stop her or to punish her? That was probably in there. That was probably in there. But I think ultimately they were looking for Jesus to stop him. So there's two things to look at there. And they were testing him in this scripture. And he had asked them, why do you test me? But then one of them, a lawyer, asked him in Matthew chapter 22, verse 35. A lawyer had asked him, testing him and saying, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment of the law?" What's the greatest commandment? We talked about that last week. And so Jesus was posed with this question. And what did he say? He said to love the Lord your God with all your heart and your soul and your mind. That's the greatest. And they were wanting him to choose maybe something different. Maybe they were wanting him to say something different to accuse him of. They were looking for him to slip up. But that wasn't going to happen with Jesus. What's going to happen with him? And listen, let's look at Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 through 20. Matthew chapter 5, verses 17 through 20. And let's see what it says there. It's talking about doing away with the law. All right, here it is. Finally got there. Verse 17, it says, "Do you think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets? I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law till all is fulfilled. Whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you that unless," and listen to this, we're talking about motives of the Pharisees. Look, let's pay attention to this very closely. "For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven." That shows their motives that were totally opposite of what God wanted them to be, what they should have been. They were not in line with what he was trying to do. And I know this, looking at motives, it's difficult to see this. It's difficult to see someone trying to stop Jesus and what he was trying to do and spread the gospel and be an example and show love. But he was always interfered with. But he said, I do not come to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. Jesus, in this story we're reading in the key scriptures, we'll look back at it, as he told them, he said, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." So we see in this story that they heard this, and then they began to think, and then they began to realize that they couldn't pick up a stone. Who was the only one that could have picked up a stone in this lesson? Jesus was the only one that could have picked up a stone. But his teaching on top of teaching, shows us that he was the only one that could have, but he chose not to. Okay, he forgave her, and he forgave her sin. Right in the middle of everything, he says, "Woman, where are those accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?" They were in the beginning, but she said, No one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, "Neither do I condemn you." He didn't condone it, but he didn't condemn her. He said, "Go and sin no more. He forgave her. Just like the two thieves that are on the cross. One was forgiven and one wasn't. One said, remember me in paradise. And look what happened. He was remembered. He said, today you'll be with me in paradise. Jesus showed them how they should take care of things, how to forgive people. And they were the ones that brought her in, but Jesus forgave. And said, so where are the people that accused you? And they weren't, they were backing off, leaving. He said they were beginning with the oldest, even to the last. But look what he says in verse 12. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. What is he saying there? That he's the light of the world, and he's shining his light on all darkness, which takes darkness away. These lights take darkness away. Jesus, in the midst of trials and sin and things, he brings light to that. And he showed the light that day in this lesson. He shined the light on sin in two different ways. For the woman that they had drug in and the Pharisees that were trying to do wrong. He shined the light on the subject. So what was their motive? To entangle, to accuse him, and to test him. Now, I want to turn the focus a little bit to what's our motive. What should be our motive? Our motive in Matthew chapter 28, verse 16 through 20. We were there just a little bit ago. Matthew chapter 28. Let's look at this. Verse 20. Okay, it says, teaching them to observe all things I've commanded you. Well, let me start over. Let me start at the beginning. It's 18 or 16. I'm sorry. All right. The 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and name of the Son, and name of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, to the end, even to the ends of the age. So the Great Commission. What should our motive be? When we do things, we have motives behind everything that we do. But as far as being a Christian and walking with God, our motive should be good, should be to fulfill the Great Commission. So you say, well, how do we do that? We follow God's word. We follow him. So if anything is going to stop the Great Commission, that should not be our motive. Our motive should be to complete this, to fulfill this, to be behind that, and to try to move forward. And he's showing them that this is what he asked them to do. This is what he taught them to do. That he's been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. So that's one motive. Our motive should be geared towards that. Geared towards the Great Commission. Also in Matthew chapter 6:33, let's go look at that. And it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. See, seeking God, building up his church, we must seek God. Our motive must be, if we're going to fulfill the Great Commission and build his church, our motives must be seeking God first. And this verse is how we build God's kingdom, is seeking him first. Because if we seek anything else or any other way, it's not going to work. And it says all these things will be added to you. What things are we talking about? The things that we need to build the ministry, the things of anything that God we need, God will supply through seeking him first. He should be first. It's our priority list that he should be at the top of that. So our motives should be geared towards building his church in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. And working in harmony, Philippians chapter 2, let's look at that. Philippians chapter 2. Therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having this same love, being of one accord. There's a lot of good stuff in there, but being in one accord, of one mind, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit. By in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. Let each of you look and not only for his own interest, but also for the interests of others. We talked about it in Sunday school this morning, humility. And the only way we can reach others is getting down on the level that we can reach others. We can't think of ourselves higher than them. We must be willing to get down and do what needs to be done to reach them, work with them. And that's what it takes. But being in one accord, our motives must be that. Any motive other than working in one accord is the wrong motive. Any kind of motive other than that is stopping it. And then the next scripture, Colossians. Let's look over there. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 17. Says, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, put on tender mercies, kindness, humility, meekness, long-suffering, bearing with one another, and forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you, so you must do. But above all, these things put on love, which is the bond of perfection. You see, Jesus, in this story that we read in the key text, that Jesus forgave her. Now, Jesus knew their thoughts when she was pulled in. He didn't realize, I don't think, maybe that they were going to plan this, but when they came in, he knew automatically what was going to happen. He knew what to do. He wasn't really, he was ready, he was prepared. So, but that's what he did. He forgave her, forgiving one another. If anyone has a complaint against another, even as Christ forgave you and I, he's done that. And that's what we should do. To work in harmony, we must forgive. And also, Romans chapter 12, let's look over there. Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, 16. It says, we're to be of the same mind toward one another, and do not set your mind on high things, but associate with the humble. Do not be wise in your own opinion. And it's like I said, that's what we talked about in Sunday school, is being humble. And not thinking above anything, not being high, setting our mind on high things. Because if we think too highly, we're going to think we haven't made and we don't need Christ. We don't need to help anyone else. So these motives, our motives should be to work in harmony. I found, does any of you guys know what a master link is? Raise your hand. If you've ever dealt with a master link. Oh, we got some ladies too. Master link. There you go. You know what a master link is? Well, those of you who don't know, it's something that you have to have in a chain of any size. You have to have that master link. And I have one here. You can't really see it, but it's a piece that goes in a chain. But it's actually, it's exactly what it's called, the master link. So I found this at work a couple of years ago, and I said, you know, I'm going to use it in a sermon. Well, today's the day. But what I want you to remember about this is that the chain is useless without this master link. Your bicycle, when you were pedaling that bicycle when you were little, you were relying on this master link to get the job done. And without it, it's not going to work. If you didn't put this on correctly, it wasn't going to work. But this was what held it together. And my example in bringing this to your attention about a master link, I thought Christ is our master link. Christ is the one that attaches the chain, which is the church, us, each individual, a chain link, bringing us together, holding us together. And being a chain, you can hang on the wall as a chain. You could be complete, not really doing anything. But you'd be a chain. You'd be a church, or you'd be a body of people. But this, the head of the church, the master link. But the thing is we don't want to just hang on in a parts house waiting to be used. We're a church ready to be used. We should be. That should be our motive. And this chain link, when it's brought together, it's brought together by this master link. And God wants us to be geared towards moving forward. You ever try to pedal a bike backwards? It doesn't work. It's not designed to go backwards. But this holds it together. They're gears in which the chain must ride on to go straight. If it gets loose, something happens and it gets loose. Or something happens, it will jump track. But God wants the church to work in harmony together, working on gears to do what? Not just to turn, not to have motion, not to spin our wheels. You can jack that bike up and pedal it all day long. It's just getting exercise, but you're not going anywhere. The thing God wants is for us to get on that, be a church, work in harmony, go forward, working together. You can't have pieces of chain over here and pieces that it doesn't work like that. But working together and actually getting somewhere, actually accomplishing something. And if we do that, relying on Him as our master link, we can get there. So I thought you might, some of you guys knew about that master link and you've dealt with that before. He is our master. He holds us together. And holding on to Him, we all move in the same direction. We should go forward. We should be His church working together for good. A church without a God is not a church. We're just a body. We're just people. Jesus did not condemn her. He didn't condemn her in the key scriptures. He didn't condone it, but He didn't condemn her. The amazing thing here is that He forgave her. And He turned the scriptures around. He turned them around to where the ball was in their court by saying, "He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first." Was she guilty? Yes. Did she deserve a stoning? Well, according to the law, she did. But what did Jesus do? We all deserve to be stoned. We're all sinners. We've all fallen short. Romans 3:23, "For we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." And for the wages of sin is death, we know that. But Jesus showed forgiveness to her, and now she's going to go tell other people. And Jesus has shown it to us by forgiving us. And that's the amazing part of the story, is that He did that. Now, He could have sat there and talked about law all day long, talking about commands. He could have taught them a lesson in commands, but He did teach them a lesson. But He actually went ahead and went to court and dealt with this issue in front of these people, the Pharisees and all the other people that are around, to show them that they can forgive. He didn't condemn her, so why should they condemn Jesus? Why should they try to even condemn Him? The light in the story is the last verse. Jesus spoke to them saying, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of the world. That's Jesus. That's the God we serve. That's the one that we put our trust and our faith in, our faith and trust in. And he's willing to forgive us wherever we're at, no matter what. The awesome thing, the thing I appreciate most about being a Christian is knowing that he forgives. That he, each day that I mess up, he gives me a new slate. That's the God we serve. That's who we serve. And he's willing to forget. He's willing to erase it. So the question is, what's our motive? Our motive should be good, pure, loving, and kind. They should be for and not against. To work, fulfilling the Great Commission, building his church, and working in harmony. Christ showed his example that day, and there was no stones that were even picked up by him or anyone else. And I truly believe our government, our all across the nation, all across the land, I think people have forgotten about this. They've forgotten that there's no stones that need to be thrown because there's forgiveness. But they're quick. The problem now with people around us is they think they can pick the stones up and start to throw. They're quick, too quick to do that. They're too quick to do that. But Jesus, if we're Christians, we're not going to do that. We're going to follow his directions and follow him, and our motives will be true. Our motives will be right. And they'll be for him and not against him. And that's the only way we can move forward is doing that. And I know we're in some difficult times, but God is in control. God loves you. God created you, and you're here for a purpose. And he's always taking care of his people. But who's the one that normally fails him? His people. We fail. He knows that. That's why he's here. If we were not broken, we wouldn't need Christ. If we weren't broken people, we wouldn't need Christ. We wouldn't need God. But God knows since Adam and Eve, we've needed a Savior. We've needed a Savior. If you would have been the only one, he would have done the same thing for you. Done the same thing. You see, if there's two people in a lake and they're drowning, God forbid you ever have to run across this. There's two people in a lake and they're having difficulties. Whether your kids or someone else's, or God forbid. But listen, you can only go out and save one of them. Which one would it be? Which one would it be out of the two? God can do both at the same time. You see, we're limited what we can do. But through God, and God through us, in his power, not our power. We talked about that Wednesday night. Karen brought up about, you know, it's God's power, not ours. But he has the ability to save all of us at the same time. His blood is good enough to cover all of our sins at the same time. And what he did on the cross stands. It's still real. So our motives should be for him to move forward, not to try to stop things, not to try to complicate things. We don't serve a God of chaos, do we? We don't. So I want us to remember that he is still in control, and even despite what we see around us in the news, that God is in control. He loves us, and he'll never leave us and never forsake us, always be there for us. John's going to come, and we're going to give an invitation, and I just pray that you put your trust in Jesus Christ as your master. Because he can hold everything together. And right now, the times we're going through, we have to do that. We have to keep him in our focus. Our eyes have to be on him at all times. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Father, I just I pray, Father, that your will be done in this invitation, that, Father, you would be in control. Father, that if there's a decision that needs to be made, that someone, they would make it today, right where they're at, just come to know you. Because the decision, if there's a decision in this place that needs to be made to accept you, then that's the most important decision they'll ever make. And a lot of people, they think they have time. They think they can wait. But we know who holds tomorrow, but we don't know what tomorrow holds. We're not sure. But if you're born again, if you know Jesus, if you trust in Jesus, then you're going to be with him for eternity. And I don't want you to miss out on that. I want you to know him. I want you, if you want to know Christ, if you want to accept the Master, your Savior, if you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want you to pray this with me. Father, I am a sinner. Father, I know I am. And Father, I've sinned and fallen short. But God, I believe in you that you died on the cross, that you rose again on the third day. And you rose for me. And Father, I confess my sins to you. That Father, I've sinned and I confess them to you. And I ask you to be the Lord of my life. Please come into my heart and guide me. Be the Lord of my life. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, every head bowed, every eye closed. If you prayed that prayer, you're a born-again Christian. And you'll be with him for eternity. He loves you. And that's his will, is for us to come to know him, to be with him. He created us for us to be with him. So in a minute, we're gonna open the invitation. You come forward. If you've made that decision, come forward and share it with me. I'm not gonna embarrass you. I just want to hear the good news that you've come to know Christ. And if there's any other burdens that you want to lay down at this altar, please come forward. Please come forward and lay those down. God, we love you. We thank you for the opportunity to be here today. We pray these things in your holy and precious name. Amen. Y'all go ahead and stand if you would. People continue to pray and lay their burdens down, and you continue to pray where you're at. There's so many things happening around us that we need to lift up to God. We need to lay them at his feet, bring our prayers and supplications to him and hand them over to him. He'll take care of them. One more stanza of invitation, and then we'll close.
The sound of the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is rising.
Amen, church. It's good to hear you sing. That's a beautiful sound to be able to hear us sing to the Lord. And you go ahead and be seated right now. We're going to take up the offering. Ask our ushers to come forward. All right, and I appreciate y'all being obedient and continuing to give to God's give to His kingdom, and I pray that we'll continue to worship in this and as we go. And Emmett, would you voice our prayer? Amen. That was awesome. It was Zeke last week, and then, yeah, John's got talented family. Let's all stand if you would. We're going to be dismissed, and thank you for coming today and being a part of worship. And I'm going to ask Wade Lott if he would close us in a word of prayer.
your presence there is peace. In your presence we are free. There's no better place to be. There's no better place to be. In your presence.